Hello everybody and welcome back to Steve on Steve Plays Ostalgie. This is the newest game from Kremlingames, the guys who made Crisis in the Kremlin, which is one of my favorite games of last year and probably one of my favorite political slash strategy games of all time, because I think it was great in terms of managing the economy and politics and diplomacy. Yeah, that was a really good game, and they promised to make a successor game to it set in the Eastern Bloc, and they've done it. And this is it, Ostalgie. It's set in the, I think it's 1989 rather, and you get to play as either the GDR, Bulgaria, or Romania, as far as I can remember. And in the future DLC or updates, they're planning to include some of the other Eastern Bloc nations, and maybe either Yugoslavia and Albania, from what I've heard, which is really exciting. And it's more or less Crisis in the Kremlin, but on a much smaller scale, with since you're playing one of the Warsaw Pact countries in Eastern Europe, but also with a lot more, you know, a lot of different things to consider. But yeah, instead of just talking about it for ages, let's get right into it. New game, yeah. So yeah, this is the new selection menu. So here you see the USSR, who you got to play as in Crisis in the Kremlin, except you got to play it from 1985, I believe, from the death of Chernenko, except here it's 1st of January 89. So Gorbachev is in power, Glasnost and Perestroika is in full swing, and the Soviet Union is swiftly collapsing, as is the Eastern Bloc and the Warsaw Pact in general. This is a bad thing, of course, and we'll try to stop it in this playthrough, or the series maybe. At least we'll try, and if that fails, we'll try to preserve our nation. Now, Bulgaria and Romania are very interesting to play as they have somewhat different politics. For example, Romania is a lot more authoritarian than the other Eastern Bloc nations, which is done to reflect the rule of Ceausescu in Romania, which was a lot more, well, authoritarian than the others, such as Zhivkov, for example, in Bulgaria, or Honecker in the GDR. And speaking of Honecker in the GDR, that's who we'll be playing as in this playthrough. Now, as we can see here, it's in the Warsaw Pact, it's part of Comecon, the Council of Mutual Economic Assistance, I think that's what it stood for, and it's conservative, so yeah, it's socialist and unlike the authoritarian Romania. So yeah, let's dive right into it. So in order to get achievements in this game, you need to select these three difficulties: party doggery, that basically makes internal politics inside of your country a lot more basically shitty, which will enable that. Pressure from Moscow, that means Gorbachev will try to pressure us into doing reforms and stuff, which, yes, we'll turn that on. And Western propaganda, which we also will turn on. And there you see, achievements can be unlocked, so yes, let's get right into it. Excellent. So, the map is quite different, and it doesn't feature the whole world because, well, you know, you're not trying to influence the entire world, you're just trying to survive and, you know, keep your country together in the last years of the Cold War. And yeah, for those of you who have played Crisis in the Kremlin or have watched me play Crisis in the Kremlin, this will be quite familiar but also very different in several ways. The game is very different in the sense that you have to take into account a lot of different things. For example, there's unity in the party, which is the political sphere, which I'll talk about in a second. Basically, party unity is how much the party members like you. And the GDR, the party members are very conservative, so they don't like reform, etc., etc. Things like automation and basically, you know, changes. They don't like changes. They're very conservative, very Brezhnevite, that kind of stuff. Here, approval from the USSR, that's fairly self-explanatory. It's how much the big brother of the Eastern Pact nations approves of us. And yeah, that's pretty self-explanatory. And as soon as party unity reaches fairly low, there's a chance of a party coup happening, and there are certain ways you can prevent that from happening, which I will go into, and hopefully I'll execute them. Then there's support of the people, that's also fairly self-explanatory. If that gets low enough, there'll be protests and riots and events that will destabilize your country even further. Basically, it's a bad thing. Then there's Westalgia, or Westalgia, however you want to pronounce that. That's basically how much your people want to live like in a Western society with a Western way of life, as opposed to Ostalgie, which is the name of this game, which I will go into a bit more detail later. Probably one of the biggest changes from Crisis in the Kremlin is Crisis in the Kremlin was a turn-based game, whereas this one is real-time. So hopefully as the time goes on, I'll have a bit more time to talk. Here is standard of living, which obviously the higher that is, the more content the population was, the lower Ostalgie will be. And the GDR is considered probably the easiest of the three that I've played so far, or at least I would consider the easiest, because it starts with a relatively high standard of living, which is obviously helpful. Then diplomatic reputation, conservative, that shows our government type. This is basically how the rest of the world views you, the rest of the world outside of the Warsaw Pact, I mean. And that, you know, impacts certain events and stuff, and can be quite nasty if it goes quite low. Actually, as far as I know, it doesn't even have to go that low for nasty events to start popping up, but we'll take care of that. Socialist camp stability, so this is obviously important. This is a general kind of summary of how stable the Warsaw Pact is. I'm pretty sure that if it goes below 95, bad events start happening, so we're going to want to raise that as soon as possible. And this is our budget, that's fairly self-explanatory. Unlike crisis in the Kremlin, where you deal with tens and hundreds of, you know, billions of dollars and stuff, here the budget is a lot smaller, which I guess is to reflect the much smaller economies of the Warsaw Pact nations. Especially Bulgaria, they have a very poor economy in this game, and I suppose in reality in the time they did. There's three map modes. There's government, which shows the kind of government or political leanings that those countries have. For example, if we click on the Soviet Union, the USSR, it shows socialism. Now, if we click on Finland, it shows liberalism. Closed trade, yeah, it doesn't matter. If we click on the FRG, it's also liberalism. We click on France, also liberalism. Turkey, okay, these are NATO countries, so they're all liberalism. The NATO countries are considered as like one block, which is interesting, I suppose. If we click on Romania, it's also socialism. However, if we click on Hungary, it's reformism, sacreformism. That, if you are not aware, is the symbol of social democracy. And that's basically symbolized that by this point in the Cold War, Hungary had transitioned from a relatively socialist state to a more Western sacreformist state. And the same is obviously for Yugoslavia, which at this point was falling into civil war. Albania is, of course, still socialist, at least it was several years back before Hoxha died, but now that Hoxha's dead, and I think it's Raja who's in power? Yeah, Albania is rapidly transitioning towards a Western economy. Libya is socialist, Afghanistan, of course, the official Afghani state is socialist, and for example, you know, India, sacreformist, China, sacreformist, which, yes, reflects the policies of Deng Xiaoping, who I think was still in power at that point. And the, you know, the whole China socialism with Chinese characteristics, etc., etc. Then there's Japan, there's liberalism, and it's influenced by the USA, of course. Then there's the military map mode, which basically shows the military alliance, essentially. So the red one shows the Warsaw Pact, that makes sense. Then the blue one is essentially, you know, the American sphere, so to speak. You see, influenced by the USA, NATO is, you know, obviously NATO, the FRG is influenced by the USA, France influenced by the USA, same as for Israel, of course, and you can't actually click on any of the Arabian Peninsula countries except Yemen, which is interesting. Iran is authoritarian and it's not American aligned, which of course makes sense because at that point, and still is, it was under the rule of the radical Islamic theocracy, which is still in power. And of course, you know, Japan is influenced by the USA. Then economical, this shows the economic model, or rather the economic union that it's part of. So, for example, all of the Warsaw Pact nations and some other ones, for example, Mongolia isn't in the Warsaw Pact, but economically it's part of Comecon, the Council for Mutual Economic Assistance, and so is Vietnam, and so is Cuba, but Cuba is not in this game. Although it might come up in an event, I haven't encountered it from what I've played. I haven't played this game for a very long time, I basically haven't played it at all. This is more or less a fresh preview. You know, I've played it enough to get the grasp of the mechanics and the basics of the game, and I'm not very good at it, so this might turn out to be a very short series. But yeah, now that we've gone through the map modes, let's go through these tabs here. Politics, this is the internal politics of the country that you're playing. This is interesting, this is the number of agents. These are like the kind of, it steadily ticks up and you can influence it with other things, which I'll go into later. But this is basically they're like their points that you get to do certain actions. Like for example, in the USSR you get to encourage the conservatives and you need to see free agent, three free agents, etc. Now, this is your party leader. This is good old Eric Honecker. I think his name is Eric. I may be wrong, but it's definitely Honecker. Great guy. Then there's the Sovmin, which is the Minister of the Interior. And this is the Stuff Guy, supporter of the growth of profit, unity, and Stasi strengthening. That's pretty great, we'll probably keep that. Yeah, in case I didn't make it clear, we're gonna try to stay conservative, stay GDR. We won't assent, to Gorbachev's reforms and stuff. We won't go too authoritarian like Romania. We'll just try to, you know, keep it as it is, you know. Obviously, we'll try to improve some things. We'll try to do some automation, which I'll go into in a second. Sorry, just need some water. I get very thirsty. Yeah, we'll try to do some progress, and that will cause a bit of problems with party unity, but hopefully that will be resolved successfully. So let's see. Cinderman, moderate reformist, nope. And Modro Gorbachev's friend. So we don't want either of those, so we'll keep Stoff. Or rather, Stoff, I'm not sure how to pronounce his name. Then ideology. We have Hager, professor of wallpapers, supporter of preserving traditions, party hierarchy, and Stasi strengthening. If you don't know what the Stasi is, that's short for the Staatssicherheit. I'm bad with German words. And they were like the state police force, or rather security forces. Well, some people call them the secret police, but that's not entirely accurate. There's Kleiber, technocrat, fighter for automation, who annoys the party. So this guy will decrease party unity, and we don't want to do that from the very beginning. And this, we don't have a lot of time in this game, you know. In Crisis in the Kremlin, you could essentially go forever, you know. The game ended in 1996, I believe, so you had 10 years, essentially, to do whatever you want. But you also keep playing. In this game, you only have 3 years, but that's alright, because time goes a lot more slowly here, because it's real time. So let's see. Technocrat, we won't go for this guy yet. We might go for him later, though, once we're more, you know, established and secure. Shabowski, that's a pretty funky name. Ryneck, I don't know what that means. Partocrat, who tries to sit on 2 chairs. So this guy looks like a party climber, and we don't want him. So everything is fine as it is. This is our, this is our parliament. Yeah, 319 seats belong to the SED, which is the leading Marxist-Leninist party, which is fine. We'll keep it this way. We won't ban any parties because, well, they have a minority, they're not a threat. And plus, banning parties makes everybody upset. Yeah, that's pretty much it for the politics screen. This is threat from NATO. This increases when you do things like send military aid and try to expand and stuff like that. And as soon as the Warsaw Pact starts crumbling and the USSR falls and stuff like that, if that's high, the US and NATO might, you know, come to your country to, you know, bring democracy and freedom, you know, knock knock, it's the United States, that kind of thing. Yeah, so let's go to science. Science, it's fairly rudimentary in this game, compared to Crisis in the Kremlin, in which it was also fairly rudimentary, but here it's even more simplified, which is fine, because, as I said, you don't have nearly as much time in this game as you do in Crisis in the Kremlin. So, I was saying earlier that the GDR starts out relatively easy, and that's true, because they already have 2 technologies researched, which is great. So, you don't have to go into these, because these make partocrats really upset. Because this is automation, this is genetics, and the old party hardliners don't like change, but we already started with 2 of them, so we don't actually have to do them, which is great. This really improves, you know, this decreases our need for import, this is increases our budget a bit, increases our standard of living a bit, this is all great. And this increases sovereignty, increases standard of living, yeah, it's pretty awesome. So we'll research the re-equipment of special services. You see, it decreases Ostalgie, which is obviously great, increases our pool of agents, which is also awesome, and unity in the party, just what is there not to like. The description is, our special services should be equipped according to the latest technology to ensure the internal and external security of our state. Yep, we'll start that. That'll take 360 days, so a year. And there are some buildings you can build, which I'll go into very soon, which increase that, and that's, we're going to want to prioritize those. Later you can do, you know, mass introduction of video surveillance, which will obviously help keeping the state together, and then you SORM. This is basically like intense surveillance. Which, yeah, we'll see what happens. I don't know if we'll even get to that point, because as I said, I'm pretty bad at this game. So yeah, let's go into economy. And yeah, this is a bit weird. It has a bit of a papers please vibe, which is cool. So here's our capital. There's 5 regions, as far as I could tell, in each of the nations, and you can build improvements in them, which is pretty cool. You know, it's a bit of a weird kind of mobile game feature, but it works, so why the hell not? So in the capital, we of course have Lenin Square. That monthly support of the people is increased. That's obviously a good thing. Foreign intelligence department, this is not too great. Berlin Wall, of course, how could you not have that in the capital? That's weekly approval from the USSR decreases because of, you know, Gorbachev and everything. Ostalgie decreases, which is great, and more agents, so we'll keep that. We might want to tear this down a bit later. Yeah, these 3 buttons are interesting. So this one basically lets you destroy the building, which frees up the slot. So you have to spend money to open up slots to build more stuff. So if you want to build more stuff but you have a useless building, you can demolish it, which, you know, is pretty cool. You can tell to stop work, so it will stop draining the budget if you're really spare for cash, which, I mean, ideally you wouldn't have to do that. And then this is the button for privatization. This is basically once you're, if you like go full reformist and you fully reform your government, you can start privatizing things, which will make them easier in your budget. But I'm sure there are other drawbacks, which I can't remember at the moment. Factory of electronics. Decreases the budget, decreases the Ostalgie, and increases the standard of living and develops science. So that's obviously great. Let's see, here we have industry. Yeah, that's pretty standard. Special services headquarters. Decreases Ostalgie, which is great. We have a TV center. Basically, we have a lot of things that are draining the budget, but a lot of things that are also just helping generally, which is, you know, not a bad thing. Agricultural establishment, these are good, but they increase Ostalgie, so you want to be careful with those. And in the south is the same as in the east. So let's see, what do we want to build? Okay, I think we might want to build an army base, because those are great, because those decrease Ostalgie and agent and increase agent networks, which is awesome. This is great, as I mentioned. Alcohol factory is not too great. Lenin Square is pretty okay. It's pretty cheap and increases people's support. This is pretty useless in my opinion. This is great. We're going to want to build one of those like everywhere. Nuclear test site is also great because it increases party unity, increases support of the people, it makes NATO pissed, and it makes Russia hate us. But, you know, it makes us stronger. But here we will build probably a research institute because those are the priorities for now. We want to get our research going. So here we'll build a research institute, and we're a bit tight for cash now, so we'll sit on that money for now. Let's see how our, where's the science going? You see, look at that, 120 days, that's sped up significantly. Yeah, so that's great. Then there's these 3 tabs. There's view, which basically shows how stuff are going. So this is what we're exporting, this is what we're importing. This is obviously, if you've ever studied basic economics, there's, you know, the balance of trade, which you obviously want to export more things than you import, and you do that by signing trade deals, which I'll get into probably in the next video. Partners, these are the countries who you're trading with. This is your economic alliance, which obviously, you know, strengthens you. State debt, that's fairly self-explanatory. Debt is pretty low for the GDR, which is pretty nice. Yeah. So yeah, in about 200 weeks, we'll pay off all our debt, which is fine, because we're paying it off at a very low interest rate, which is totally okay. Borders, this is basically borders that you close and stuff. So we have 5 closed borders, and that decreases Ostalgie, which is pretty good for us. Aid, we're getting 25 Soviet aid. So yeah, obviously, as the more we piss off the Soviet Union, the less aid we'll receive. Patriotism. Patriot is basically how much people like the country. Sovereignty, this is basically how much your country is independent. It's also important to be sovereign because it shows how, you know, it reassures your people that you're a strong, independent nation, which is great. Ostalgie, which is how much people like our ideas, which is great. And situations, this is how certain wars and stuff are going. So, control in Afghanistan, there's the Afghan war, of course, which is going disastrously. And at this point, 89, this was a few months before the last troops withdrew from Afghanistan, if I remember. But they were already withdrawing troops pretty heavily at that point. So yeah, we're obviously going to want to do something about that a bit later. I'm not sure what the YDR is. probably could be Cambodia, maybe Ethiopia or Somalia, I'm not sure. I'm honestly not sure. In Europe, there's the Yugoslav War, of course, so we're going to want to help them. Then there's the Soyuz in the USSR, which basically means unity, the union, and it's at 80%. So yeah, this basically means that the Soviet Union is deteriorating. And these are the wars in Africa, Algeria, Ethiopia, Somalia. So Algeria is very close to, you know, getting it together. Where's Algeria? This is Algeria. So yeah, we might want to support them in a little while. Let's see. And yeah, that's pretty much all for this menu. And the last menu, statistics, it's pretty much self-explanatory. It's basically economic statistics. This is your GDP, this is your growth, etc. Deficit, growth, etc. Yeah, this is in real life, by the way. This is how it happened in the real world. This is, in 1989, the GDP was 148, and it kept slowly, rather quite quickly deteriorating. And so did the percentage of economic growth. And hopefully we'll be able to, you know, do better. So yeah, this will probably be the end of this video. We actually didn't get to play, but hopefully I've explained this game more or less sufficiently. This should have been a pretty decent tutorial slash intro to the game. And yeah, in the next video, hopefully we'll be able to actually get into the meat and potatoes of the game. So yeah, thanks for watching, and leave any comments in the comments below. Like and subscribe, and I will see you in the next video. Bye-bye.